There are some programs that's already out there, some ERPs that already are integrated with production systems that are available, and there are several of them that are not. This piece here, if you don't have this piece, if this isn't already done, then this is something you can have programmed for you. So pricing on that's different based on what ERP system you're using. So from there, it goes to the production management system. So the PC that I showed you earlier, this information, it could be a server, it could just be a standalone laptop to gather this information. From there, it goes to a controller. So this controller is receiving the information, order data coming down. From there, the controller sends information back up to the PC, and then you have production records. When I started Rollforming, I did not know this piece was available to me. So I just collected all the information here. So this could be a standalone system. These systems have their own inventory management. They have a history. All the information that you can send all the way back up here to the ERP can just be stored right here. So you don't have to have this piece if you don't want it. The advantage of it is if I have it in the ERP, then my salesperson can know order completions. They can know different information. I can tie inventory. I can put inventory in just the ERP, and then this can be tied directly back to the inventory here. Is there any questions on the data flow? So what are some of the benefits of a production management system? Mistake proofing. How many of us have ever ran the wrong column? I have. It's very costly. Ran the wrong links. So if the operator enters the order in, the thing to keep in mind is the closest person to the truth is the person taking the order. So every human being that I enter into the system enters in error to the system. So when you're small, this isn't that big of an issue. But as you grow, that error gets larger and larger. It becomes more of what customers face their opinion of your business from them. The next is on-time deliveries. If I can see and predict what orders are being completed, how soon I get orders done, I can have better customer service. I can have perfect accounting and inventory control. I can eliminate waste and grow in capacity. One of the first things I did when I got my first production system, I was putting cover sheets on everything. And at the end of the year, I made sure that I tracked that in as scrap piece, and I found out that it was costing me $90,000 a year with cover sheets on. And customers were also short ordering by the cover sheet. So I actually increased sales and decreased my expenses because I was able to see exactly what that piece was costing me. Next is flexibility. So you know how business is today, in the fact that it's pretty much I order at noon and I want it by 5. It's usually what customers want. It's sometimes shorter than that. So I've got to be able to manage orders that I need to go move orders around quickly. And if I have the operator doing that, I'm not making money. So the way I view it is the person who has run the roll former is printing money. I want to print as much as possible. So if their head is down in the controller, moving orders around, entered orders in, they're not producing money. Next is management focus and capital spending. So the other thing with this too is, as I was telling you about here with scrap, one thing I found is I ran 18 different colors. The problem I had is every time I set the coil down, the outside lap would get scrapped. So in that, I was trying to figure out a way, how do I spend money? What can I spend money on to eliminate that first outside wrap, not getting scratched? I had an overhead crane, so I ended up suspending all the coils, and then I ended up purchasing four station equipment. So I kept everything off the ground, but I was able to get that data because I had the data from this telling me how much I had in scrap. So I can make capital spending decisions on the basis if I have the correct data. The other thing that happens in the data collection piece is even right now you can say, well, my guy keeps track of my downtime. My guy keeps track of the scrap. Well, they always put it in their favor. They don't want it to look as bad as it really is. So the thing that you get out of production management system is the truth. So anytime we've gone and implemented the new production management system, typically what people, what customers will say is, that can't be right. My scrap isn't that high. My downtime isn't that high. So out of this here, you get more of the truth. The other thing you get out of this is continuous improvement. Sort of the same thing here. These kind of go hand in hand. How do I get better? What's my stats? Do I work through breaks? The other thing that happens with this too is you may want to go out and buy another roll former because you think you need it. I pulled my data for 10 years on my roll former. I thought I was running hot and heavy every day. It ran 9.9% of the time. So that's how much time was actually being produced. So on the front end, on the back end, how, you know, where do you put people at? So there's some shocking information you actually get out of it once you actually collect the facts. So really what production management systems do is they make the unknowns of roll forming known. So most people, if you just have the data, you can make good business decisions. It's when you're guessing that you're not so good at it. We all know the odds of going to Vegas. And that's what you do, is if you're guessing every day how you're running your business, you're generally going to fail. So I've got this little example here that I want to go through that's just over, this is a typical roll form business and kind of a little accounting lesson here. So we just have our gross profit minus our overhead hits our net operating profit. So if I look at this, I have my gross profit on my material. I have my gross profit, selling price, and the cost of material. And most of us know that this number over here that we get to work with is very small. So we've got to make sure that we run very efficiently in the business to make sure that we're making a profit. So in that, I want to use a little example here before I finish up the accounting model, is speed versus throughput. So this is what really matters at the end of the day, is how much do you actually get out the door. So if I just put this kind of in layman terms here, is if I take a trip from St. Louis to Chicago, it's 300 miles. And I use the fastest car, one of the fastest cars that's available. It's 265 mile an hour. The trip would be 67 minutes. And my throughput on that is 265 mile an hour. Now, if I tell you I'm bringing Tyler along, it has to stop every 45 minutes. Now I got to stop. Each stop is 20 minutes. My trip time is 187 minutes. So all of a sudden, my throughput to my destination is only 96 minutes. Now, if I tell you I'm bringing the mother along, she likes to stop at flea markets, 60 minutes apiece. Now my trip is now 307 minutes, and now the throughput is only 58 minutes. So we can see here that most of us have this vehicle that would run 58 mile an hour all the way up to from Chicago to St. Louis. So if we take this model here and apply it to roll form, I have this brand new roll form. I think I got to have this that runs at, you know, say it's 500 foot a minute. It's not going to do us any good if we don't have the other pieces fixed. So in this example here, I've got a machine that runs 125 foot a minute on the throughput. But I've got 20 coil changes a shift. They're 12 minutes a piece. That gives me 240 minutes of downtime. So now I'm down to 15 minutes throughput. It's actually produced during the day. And more bad news, if I have a tooling change, that's 35 minutes. That's two of them. It gets me down to 310 minutes of downtime. So my actual throughput for the day, I'm only running that machine at 35 foot a minute throughput at the end of the day. So when I told you my machine only ran 9.9% of the time, the reason is it could run, my machine could run 165 foot a minute. This was realistic what was happening. So what really matters is how do I manage these pieces here, is what makes me money. Is this right here, if I could run it this, I want to run it to max capacity all the time. That's going to get me the most money in my pocket. So if I take this back to roll forming, back to the accounting part of it, we take the total time available minus downtime times 135 foot a minute, it gives me $41,850. And I apply that to just the margin that I showed, which was 50 cents a foot. This gets me to net operating profit. This is perfect condition. This gets me a net operating profit of $1.1 million. Now, if I just do one thing, if I take the amount of time that the average person puts orders in a controller today in typical panel business, that's 35 minutes a day. That little bit of time that the machine is not running costs you almost $500,000. That's one thing. So if there's only one thing that you do with it, is take orders from the ERP down to the controller, you will be making, you will pay for that production system in a short period of time.
Build up.
The other thing that goes with that is just errors. So this here is just saying I'm dropping orders directly down. This isn't counting any errors. This isn't counting any other items in that. So one thing alone will make your money back in short order. It's just dropping orders to the line. Now if I take that and my stacker is not running, won't let me run at 135 foot a minute, I'm losing 15 foot a minute because the stacker has an issue. That little bit of footage over the course of a year now costs over $100,000. So if I know what the machine is capable of running and I see how it's not performing, I can now put numbers in this and go, you know what? I probably gotta go spend that money right now and get that fixed. Or get a new stacker. Same thing here too, when I talk about scrap, the issue I had. I'm sending my part a scrap because of coil chains, outside wrap. That little bit cost me more money. $100,000. So this is the importance of having a production management system, is it gives me the ability to see what is actually costing me money in my business. Because not all the time can we grow our business and get more business. We can just get more out of what we have. That puts a lot of money in our pocket. This is also assuming we can sell everything. So this is just an example. I love to have the first model in the day, but I never got to see that all that way. So what I'm going to cover here next, these are just features of production management systems. So a good production management system should have real-time metrics. So I want to know how I'm running right now. What does it look like? I want to have productivity tracking, reports, data to actually see what I'm doing. I need to see my history, and I need to see my progress. Next would be coil validation. So as we talked, running the wrong collar. How do I prevent that from happening? How do I make sure that the forklift operators know when to bring the next coil? Scrap tracking. In today's market, the model I just showed you there, to make up a cost of $2, it takes me four times the amount of material to run to get that money back. And that doesn't include the labor. So at the end of the day, if you only worked on one thing, reducing scrap, that reducing scrap goes right to profitability. That's money back in your pocket. So if I can eliminate errors, eliminate scrap, but again, I've got to know how much scrap I'm actually producing so I know how to tackle it. Next is downtime tracking. So how much time am I down? When I showed you the example of being down 12 minutes for a coil change, how can I get it down to 6 minutes? Do I need to spend money on a double-ended painter? Do I need to have two coil cars? Do I need to get an overhead crane? I need to know what I'm spending so that I can actually put the numbers together and know what my ROI on it is. So we'll look at some examples of real-time metrics. This looks really good on my computer screen, but the projector isn't really fine, so I apologize for that piece. But this here is just showing an example of metrics, real-time metrics on one machine. So up here, you can kind of see the green, see the orange, and see the red. In this example here, green is actually how much time I actually run. This is scheduled downtime. This is unscheduled downtime. And this is typical of most roll formers. This is what you'll end up seeing. There's gonna be more red than there is in the green. So what I wanna go do is see what is causing this issue. So from here, there's OEE, there's availability, scrap, there's all these different metrics that I can see. In this example, I've got pretty much most of paperwork points here on one sheet so I can see. What you can't see is what I show here is what's in red is running below par, what's in green is running above par, what's in yellow is close to being in the red, and then gray is running good. So there's different ways in which these metrics can be displayed. The key with it is just being able to see some basic metrics. And what I can tell you is metric-wise, if you give any production data to an operator, so if right now if your operator doesn't know how many foot a day they're running, how many foot a month they're running, and you go to given data. I did a little study with a customer. I was trying to get him a new production management system. And in that, I had them go in for 1 week. They would run the same product, same operator, for 2 weeks. The first week, we just went to put it in. We run it off the report. We just did one report, showed the footage. Handed that report to the operator and the manager. The next week, at the end of the week, we pulled the same report and go back to them. Production went up over 30%. So human nature will be is if I have data, if I'm not being managed and I don't know my stats, you're never going to really get super performance out of it. But if I can, the quicker and more often I can get data to an operator, the more production they will produce just by human nature. You don't have to do any improvements other than start giving them, here's your stats for the day. Make sense? So down here too is on this sheet here. This, you can't really see, this is a downtime. So these are the leading causes of death of downtime. Leading causes of death on scrap. Over here is actually just what production is for the day, what I have to do. And then down here at the bottom is a pretty powerful tool. This is predictive scheduling. So you always tell a customer, hey, I'll have your order done at 4. How many times did it always happen? I got it right about 50% of the time. So the advantage of this piece here, this is a rolling piece that as I'm producing, I can see when that order is going to be completed. This is a powerful tool for somebody in the office so they can actually see the order. This here is the actual order I've produced. This is the coil changes. Down here is the tool changes. So this gives the ability for somebody in office to be able to tell a customer with some reasonable number that this is when the order is going to be produced. Any questions with real-time metrics? Next is Andon displays. As I was talking about getting data to the customer, or data to the operator, I can give a report once a week. I give it to him once a day. The best thing I can do for him is put a display up here. It gives me simple metrics, and I display them every 4 seconds. So if I'm constantly pumping the data out to the operator, what's going to happen to my performance? It's going to go up. I don't have to go out there and tell them, hey, you're not running fast enough. If I give them the information, and this is one thing I didn't quite understand, is for some reason we get in our car. We got all these gauges. We know how fast we're going. We know we're in drive. We know if we're running off. And today, if we're running in the middle lane, we get a seat vibrates. We get all this information that tells us we're not going something right where we need to be at. When we go to manufacturing and we ask the operator to produce money, and we give them an on-off button. That's it. So they don't know how they're going, how fast they're going, what I need, how much do I need, where's my goals. So when we drive down the road, we've got speed limits. Okay, I need you to be on 55. Well, we need to apply these same principles to manufacturing so we can get some better results out of it. So this Andon board is something, it's not really a new concept. Toyota had it, I don't know, 30, 40 years ago, and they just did it simple with red, green, and yellow lights. So this concept here, the goal with this is to keep it very simple and frequent changes. I want the data updated as quickly as possible. What I found in operation with an operator, to get my operator to perform better, I need to be on my team. What I found is going up talking to the operator, is I want to talk to him about life outside of work and just a little bit of time about what was going on. So if I have this here, when I walk out in the shop, I can, everybody sees the data. So you get a little peer pressure with how they're running. So everybody knows, everybody's on board with how much we're getting produced out the door. I want one goal to be scrapped at 2%. I can put that up there and we start running over 2%, everybody starts hollering. So the power of just giving information to your team will increase your productivity at a minimum of 20% if you're given no data. Productivity tools. This is just a production summary. Again, there's several different formats you can do with the data. So you can customize the data. The good thing is you're pulling all this data and it's in a raw format. So if you don't like the formats that are available, you can take it, you can take the data and create your own. This production data here, production summary report, is again just using what we already used in the real metrics, but this is static and is history. So this is in the past. The real-time metrics is what's happening right now. This is given over a given time frame. So what I like about it is at a quick glance, I can see what I need to focus on. I can see the red. I know what's green and what's running above par. That, and then I also have like these little charts here. This gives you data over the last 20 days. So I can kind of see my history. So was this just an anomaly over that time frame? Was the data good over over time period? Next is production explorers. So this is another helpful tool that would help you out. This is all relationship-based data. So what's tough to see is this says shift. This is material, machine, this is material, product, operator coil, the lengths. And then this here is customers. So if I click on any one of these, all the data changes. So when I'm trying to find an issue, you understand, like here, I had a good production day, but why did I have a good production day? I'll click on, maybe it was the operator, so I'll click on that operator, and I'll be able to see that he was running really a bunch of long lengths. That's why I got good production. It may be that I ran material that I know runs really good. If I had a bad production day, just a couple clicks, I can see where I need to go down and drill down further. So there's paper reports that drill down further beyond this piece. This here gives you a good, quick, relationship-based information. And the thing you get out of it is, the key with it is, what I found, especially when you're small, is you're doing 10 things. I didn't have 2 hours to go over data everywhere. I want to look at it 5-10 minutes and know where I'm at. And see what the issues are, be able to address them. The next powerful thing that's in a good production management system is scheduling. So again, I do not want my scheduler and I do not want the operator to spend 2 hours a day trying to schedule stuff. So one of the benefits of a good production management system is filters. So how do my orders get filtered? So if I want to come up and say I want to run all green, I want all the green orders over the next 2 days. Two clicks, boom, and this here is a drag and drop. So I can take this information, these here are already filtered on the base of tooling, materials, and then required date, and it just keeps going back. I can change these how I want them to go. But then I can drag a whole block and go, boom, I want it here. That allows me also, the other thing that's a powerful benefit too is we call auto push. So with auto push, the benefit with that piece is if I have a bunch of orders and I send them all down the controller and I got a change, the operator has to stop and go through and sort all them different orders. If I can just put them in the top top one or two orders, and I keep everything in the background queued up. And then just send them down when that order gets below, say, 500 feet, I send the next order down. Then the schedule in the background can be manipulating the data, and then the operator only sees the orders that he has next to do. So one thing I also had issues with is if I had two shifts running, I'd get cherry picking. So the first shift would take all the gravy orders, the second shift would get all the crap. So with auto push, what that gives you the ability to do is you force the operator to do the order in the sequence you want it done. So you may have to have it in a certain sequence to go be loaded on the truck or a customer pickup. So there's a lot of different features in production and scheduling pieces, and I don't have time to go through all of them today in the period that we have. So the other key cool feature that's in this piece too is when you have predictive scheduling, I then can, you can see this little tiny triangle here. It's not, it doesn't show up at the greatest here, but it's red. That means this order's late. It's not going to get produced in time. I have one up here in yellow.
Yeah.
It says it's getting close to being late. So if I have notifications of when my order's based off of the schedule date, if I have that information, I then can go and make changes and have better customer service.
Yeah.
Make sense? Another key feature that I would like to have with that is when I have these orders here, I may have different tooling changes, different parameters that I got to put in the roll former to be able to run the product that I'm running. So I run from one product, I may have to switch to another one, I may need to change dwell times, I may need to change stack or drop time, different things like that. One other benefit with production management system is I can tie that set of parameters that particular product. So if I tie it to the product, as soon as we load it in the controller, it brings down that set of data to that controller. And then the operator doesn't have to remember to make the change. World, you don't see a whole lot of changes happen. It's even more this in custom roll forming. Sometimes in the stud world, different lengths, you got different roll times that you got to be running on it. So the other nice feature you have with the two is if I'm tied to it, then all my data is stored in the production management system. So all the parameters. So if something happened to the controller and I lost memory, I don't have to go back and figure out how to do that. As soon as I plug in a new controller, all the data is uploaded. This can happen. This can happen through software, and it can also happen through
platform.
Next, there's full validation. So, one of the benefits there is when I'm talking about having errors is if I load the wrong material. What happens when I load the wrong material? Well, that causes a significant amount of problems all the way through the system, all the way to the customer. And it's somewhat difficult to even track how much that actually costs you, especially when you've got a customer that's not happy. So, we have a couple
it's
steps.
The phone closure.
We have available in our system. This there is the warehouse management system. So what this does, this is real-time giving the list to the operator where he needs to pick up the coal at and when is it due. So it gives him a list here, which you can't see. It says -7, it's in red. This is 32 minutes out, 37 minutes out, so on and so forth. So this tells him where to pick up the material, what warehouse to pick it up to, and what machine it needs to go to. So when they pick it up, we have a two-step process in validating coils. So one, the forklift operator has to pick from a list of coils. That is in the accounting, it's first in, first out. You can kind of set it to what you want it to be. They have to pick the set of coils, and then they have to, once they select it, it'll say, this is the correct coil, the correct material. And then, from there, if they don't select the right coil, it'll ask them a reason why they didn't. And there's reasons, times, that we need to use the next material, and we're out of the gauge. Then at the end, they'll select the marker list. The goal with this is your new forklift operators, and material handling employees, they're coming more from the game. So When I grew up,
okay,
I played outside with them. Then I worked with them.
Sure, thank you.
For this generation coming in, played games, played Xbox, so on and so forth, and then they're now just learning the hands-on piece. So if I can give them, they're used to stats, so if I can give them the ability to kind of make their world a little bit in the gaming world, where they can just click on stuff and say, I got this done, and then it touches with reality of actually going loading the coil, I get a better performance, and I help them learn and be successful. From there, we have coil validation. So here we have an order that has 22 gauges. There's a tail out sensor on the roll form, so when it tails out, it triggers and gives me this screen. So it says, unloaded current material. What do I want done with it? Was the coil completed, or do I return to inventory? And the reason that's there is, I'm pretty sure most of you know that if it says there's 5,000 foot on the coil, there isn't always 5,000 feet. So we also need to know why was it input. So we select that, then we scan new coil in. So we can type it in, or we can just use a barcode scanner, a quick click, and that information's in. The goal with the barcode scanner is, again, the quicker I can gather data, and the easier I make the data. So in all of this here too, I want to make sure that any data collection from the operator is quick and easy. If I make it easy for them, they're going to collect the accurate data. If I make it tough, they're going to start finding ways around it, and then my data starts getting scraped. So this screen pops up once I put the coil in, and it says 18 gauge. This material is 18 gauge. I'm matching up materials, not necessarily. When we do validation, we're not matching up coils. We're matching, making sure we got the right material. And I get this screen. If I load the wrong material up, it says 22 gauge, and I got an 18 gauge coil, this is what's going to show. This will pop up. And it'll ask me, what do I want to do with it? I can lock the operator out from making the change and moving forward. You have to get a manager. You put a key switch on the console, and that forces some manager to make an approval on that piece. So this keeps me from making the mistake of running the wrong material. So if you got somebody, maybe like in my case, I had a gentleman who's colorblind. This here really helps out with that to make them successful. The main thing it does is I don't want to run the wrong material in the job. Any questions with coil validation? So from that, if I'm able to collect all that data, then I get a report that I can pull. This gives me, maps out all my coils. Tells me how much I'm producing. This here early on, especially early on, I started, I remember my first few orders that I ran, I had a new vendor, and I thought the guy was pretty good. But I needed a job that had 5,000 feet on it. I did the math on it. I went and picked the coil up, brought it back, ran it, and I was 1,000 foot short. What I found out was I was buying by the pounds, and I was selling by the foot. The problem is what problem happened to me there was they sent me 26 gauge for 29 gauge. So one thing I found with this here is being able to keep vendors in check is I end up going from this over the years, I end up buying by the foot. This kept the vendors. If I order 0145, I got 0145. They didn't go over, and I could also check if they got under. So this also helps too is, I think it was 2007, several large roll formers had the same issue that I did. I was out of a company out of the West Coast, and they railed all the way here. It was supposed to be some great deal, American Steel, old shoot match. Well, end up, they put the wrong substrate on it. That's why it was a great deal. So, I ended up rejecting almost 500,000 pounds. So, in that process, I'd already produced some and went on roofs. So what ended up happening was, edge creep, I ended up getting like 3/4 edge creep within 12 months. So I go through the first winter and it'd peel up. So, I had to go through and know what my liability was. So I could go through and pull from that vendor, I could go pull all my coils and know every single job that got produced. I did that in about 10 minutes. If you do it with paper, how long is it going to take you? So, with this here too, I could also give that information in a running situation back to the supplier and say, hey, this is what I have out in the field. So, knowing how your coils are running, know how much scrap there are. You may have one vendor that keeps throwing you a bunch of scrap. You think you're buying prime steel, and you're getting secondary pan as prime. You can tell that by your stats. They're giving you something that's extremely hard, that's cracking on you all the time. You can tell by how much scrap you're producing what's happening. So again, we're taking the unknowns of the business and making them known automatically behind the scenes. Next we'll cover scrap tracking. So the goal with scrap tracking is to minimize the scrap. We can minimize the scrap by optimizing the schedule. So if I take all the colors together, I run all the greens, all the blues, all the red, then I'm not loading the coil, unloading the coil. So I optimize that piece. We can also optimize cutting patterns for slip rippers and shears. You can also, by having this separation, you can also work on mistake rippers. So by dropping the coil down the line, we minimize the amount of scrap we're producing by not running the wrong work with the job. And then if we know the leading causes, we can make the fix. So instead of just a handwritten thing and scrap, because usually what happens in a paper system is somebody collects all the data, then it goes to somebody else, and they got to tally up all the data. So you just tied up two people. And usually the person tallying up, that's all they're doing, is spend all their time on the data. So literally you can get rid of that person and have it even more accurate. So with scrap reports, the thing we want to be able to do is, the theme is quick and easy. So if I pull reports and I get a Pareto chart here where I see the leading cause of death right out of the gate, I can focus on, I always look at it, okay, I'm going to focus on my top three. What are my top three issues? How can I handle it? What do I need to do? This is also where I found my cover sheet issue. This one here popped up. And then you can go do the math. Obviously, there's some operations, there's always a percentage of scrap that you can't get rid of. But the goal is, I don't want people. We also have Scrap Explorer. Scrap Explorer is the same thing as Production Explorer, except for just dealing with scrap. So this is the first thing I want to look at when I see what my scrap percentage is off my real product percentage. I look at this here, I want to understand why I'm producing scrap. Does it make sense? If it doesn't make sense, I can drill down further and get more information. How much does it actually cost? Is it necessary? Is it causing a piece of equipment? Do I got a die drag? Is my shear blade messed up? How far should I invest in my shear blades so I don't have this problem? It's a pretty cool thing, as I do. Next would be downtime tracking. So why do we want to track the downtime? I want more capacity. So I want to be able to run my machine more. Like I told you, I ran 9.9% of the time. I didn't need another machine. I just needed the remaining 20% downtime. So if you eliminate downtime, the ways we do that, data entry, coil and tag logging. So if I know how much time I'm actually loading coils, unloading coils, waiting for coils to arrive. I know if I'm waiting on coils to come in, and I list that as a downtime, it tells me that I need to do a little quicker ordering. So all our processes, if we're tracking this, the operator can give that information to us automatically, to know what we're actually ordering deficient for. We can coordinate and help minimize changeover times. So can I have the tools? When I've got to change it over, can I have all the tools over so I can make the change quick and easy instead of having to go over the tools? depends on your roll former setup or the changer. Some machines you don't need them. So, I look at my downtime reports. They look the same as scrap does. I'm looking at my leading cause of death. So I can see here what items I need to be working on. The nice thing is with the downtime and the scrap, the reasons you put in are customizable. Because not every roll form shop is going to have exactly the same downtime codes for everything. So you may want to focus on one particular item compared to somebody else. The great thing is I can put them in there and I can also exempt them. So like in the shift, at the end of the day, it automatically will go into, we'll put that information in and say, hey, we haven't ran any materials since the next shift. You know, exempt that time out. If you don't, this ends up being your top position. Make sense? We also have a construction explorer for that. Again, I can scan across the days what I want, how many days I want in the report, any of these, so I look first shift versus second shift, all my data is changing. So I can look and see, yeah, I was running this material, but I expect to have this amount of downtime because of how it works for the machine. So you can quick and easy understand where the data is, where it's making sense. I put this in here. The main purpose of this is from management point of view to employee point of view. If I look at it from management side, this looks square. If I look at it from the operator's point of view, it's round. So one of the biggest things that we have when you implement a production management system is to get everybody on the same page. So we want management to help with the operators understand that this isn't just Big Brother looking down on top. That's the first thing that happens with the operator. You're trying to watch them. You're trying to tell me I'm not doing enough. But the actual truth is that the operator is the closest one to the truth. So when I go in to work on a line, I want to talk to management for a little bit, but I really want to talk to the operator the most. Because they're closest. They have all the information. I need that. They're going to tell me why the line's not running. But I want that guy on board because if they do not enter the data incorrectly, so when we produce pieces, when we produce scrap, you have to increase the quantity of the order. I need to make sure that they put in the correct reason for the scrap. If they're down, I need them to put the correct reason in for being down. So if I don't have them on the same page, then this information coming back will be incorrect. Does that make sense? So, if I take this back through the model again, and I have all this information and I can do something about it, this is what the model ends up looking at. So, when he's down here, he's at 114K. So, after I implemented a production management system, then I have no more data entry downtime. That increases me back up to 385. Comes up to see this. I have fewer customer complaints and yield losses. Dialogue with the operator gets the stack fixed. I have capital spending on coil handling, which increases more production. OEE improves, say, 15 to 36, and then my net operating profit would increase dramatically. So if I have the data, I then can make these changes. Again, this is an example, and I'd love for this to happen like this, but it may happen in different increments. But what I can tell you is it will increase the productivity and the profitability of your business. So the main thing that I want to make sure that you understand is what production management systems do is they take the unknowns of the business and they make them known. That's all I have for presenting today. Is there any questions on this? Yep.
I don't currently have an ASC terminal on the machine.
Mm-hmm.
I have an ASC.
Yep.
And not AMS, I mean, does this, as far as the management, the floor, does that work with the different machines that may not be, have the controllers on them?
Yeah, well, all we do is you change out the controller.
Okay, so you have to change out the controller.
The controller has, yeah, you just need to change out the controller piece, and there really isn't a machine that can't get integrated. So, any systems that are out there, they're gonna want you to change the controller out, to be able to talk with the software, is how it's collecting the data.